Okay, I think it works. We'll see. Okay. So, I'm sure that at least this quarter of you that know how to write a program basically know all this again. But this is basically just very much a talk just to motivate you for why actually we need to programming. And it's, I mean, programming is, of course, we all use computers. We all know how that we can use Facebook, and we all know that we can use Word or something like that. So someone has written this program. But why should a biologist really care about programming? And of course, the reason is, and in particular, this case, why should you care about Python programming? And this is, well, the reason is, of course, because basically, as I said, the genomic data is so big, so there's no way you can handle it manually. And really, there are too many biologists that try to do it in Excel, because this is kind of standard tool for biologists. And really, Excel is quite good for some things, but it's not good for handling gigabytes of sequence data, or I mean, even your thousands or tens of thousands of experiments. And particularly, even small things, I mean, what I always try to get students to do, my students to do, is to automatize things, because you always know that if you're doing bioinformatics problems, that you do something wrong. You take the wrong data source, or you have a problem with your code, or your questions were not correctly asked, something like that. So you will always have to redo it. And it's okay once to do it, once, and then the next time, but the tenth time you have to redo almost the same thing again from start to end. It's so nice to have a small program that you just click a button, and it produces a nice graph. And let the computer work. And there are also a lot of problems that we cannot handle even on a single computer, you need a lot of more computers. But it's really this idea that whatever data you do, there's a lot of data, and just have these simple, small programs that actually can take your data and produce the graphs you want to analyze it. You don't have to spend all the time doing that. It's just, it gives you a lot of time to do other things. And of course, the good thing about Python is becoming more and more standard in bioinformatics. A lot of people use it. It's not the only thing, but it's getting kind of standard. There are, for many problems, it works very well. And it's a decent programming language that people can do. So what is programming? So programming is basically a way to describe for a computer what to do. So you have to be, and a computer is stupid. You can't just say, let's find something about protein structure and then figure out something like that. Well, you have to tell, do this, do this, do this, do that. So you have to, if you have to know something, particularly if it's automatic, it's like any machine, they're better to do automatic things. And so you had to figure out what you wanted to do, and you had to develop a task, like a pipeline of things to do. Like if you do a lab experiment, so you should take the DNA here, and you could heat it and things. You have to tell it exactly, so dividing things into small things. And then you have to write in a computer language, and then you have to test it and make sure that it works, and then, of course, it never works the first time, so 80% of the time it's offered for testing, because you haven't thought about everything. So, and then you have to implement it somehow. And this is what programming is. And how it does it is basically it has some kind of variables. A variable can be a letter, a string, a number, something that contains some information. What's it called? The object nowadays. It's implied as an object. And then we can do something with these variables. We can add them together or print them out to sort them. We can do a lot of these things with them. And you can compare them also. So you can compare, are they the same, are they different? There's one bigger than others, one longer than others. So we can do some comparisons. And also, important things often we want to do loops or sometimes. We want to repeat things at the same time. So we take every sequence in our database and we want to calculate something on it and we keep it one sequence by one sequence and one sequence. So this is kind of the basic things that every programming language does. Then you can divide it into more advanced things, etc. But that's basically, even though this program here does, it's like it has an, if I now click this button, it starts doing that. If I click my button here, it will show the next slide. So of course, programming in bioinformatics is essential. it's, at least in my mind, compared to some other disciplines, also use a lot of computers, like if you do biophysics, you do simulations, you also use a lot of computers and so on. You often end up actually to do kind of small things yourself, because you always end up, I mean, simply converting data forms. You have data from your mass spectrometer, you want to convert it to something that you can use in other programs. There's a lot of small things. It's often a bit more of, not very advanced programming, but like just the simple scripts converting things is important. And it's not one general toolbox that does everything in mathematics. There are some toolboxes that nobody uses, I think, and used to be things like that, but basically often you mix and match a lot of different things together. So often what you do is writing the glue between these boxes. You don't write a big program that does advanced computing. Well, some people do, but that's more the developers than the users. But you write the glue between them. And of course, the idea is, of course, you want to avoid repetitive tasks. So because many things you can use on web pages. There are a lot of web pages, but if you want to do it for 1 million sequences, well, most likely the web page will die or they will kick you out. And you get probably the hands and need to click 1,000 times. And of course, you want to analyze large amounts of data. And also even for the big problem now is actually handling all this data. This is if you have I think our sequences at Scilab Lab sequence like a few human genomes every day. Just store the data, and that is the final product. And of course, the raw sequence is 50 times bigger, and the raw sequence is another 700 times bigger. So even just storing the data, saving it somewhere, is computationally difficult. And of course, also as developers, often we make tools that we want other people to use. And some of these tools actually often do us web service, because it's like the if I do a tool for memory approaches, which is one of my research fields, of course I can write the code and I can give it to someone else to use the code, but most people are not going to spend the time installing the code if they only want to test one memory protein. If it's a memory protein, they want to have a web server to click on it. And then, of course, there are a number of tools that actually try to link web servers together, something like that, but so far there are a lot of standard problems with them. So this is a lot of things we do in bioinformatics and programming. So what is bioinformatics, as I said? Someone here wrote a definition. Mathematical, statistical, and computing methods to solve biological problems using DNA and amino acid sequences and related information. So actually, the key thing is that you have biological problems. So I'm editor for one of the bioinformatics journals called PLOS Computational Biology. And there we have, as a criteria for a paper, that it should provide profound new biological insights. So really, we are here to do biology. We are not here to make a better program. Or if we make a new method or program that we develop, the criteria is that this method has to have the possibility or likelihood, high likelihood to provide, to be used to find new biological insights. We want to learn new biology. And this is the key thing. We are not doing this, there are some people, but in general we're not doing this for finding computer problems. We actually do things for relevant biological questions. We want to understand biology. It's just that most biophysicians do not stand in the lab and do that. They sit in front of the computer. And the key data is often sequences. Nowadays there's a lot of other data around also, a lot of images and things like that, but in this course we will focus on sequences, both protein and DNA sequences, quite a lot of protein sequences. But basically, this is somehow the key for at least the introduction course in bioinformatics. Sequences and related information. But there are, of course, a lot of other things. Yeah. A lot of computer science things. You don't do store and analyze data. So how do you do that? And there's also a lot of simulation. So like as you talk about how regulations are happening. Because this is something you can't really handle by just having the data. You need to test it and simulate it. So you set up a system. So this one is, this gene is regulating that one. This one has what happens. You can figure out it. So it's an interaction thing between simulations and other data, but that's the kind of system technology. I think there will be more on that probably in the later courses. We'll have a very short part of it in this course. But so here are the classical bioinformatics dealing with primary sequence analysis. So this is mainly what we talk about in this course. Plus, let me teach you. So that's yeah. So it's kind of, but it's also still it's a basis for basically everything. There's, even when you do sequence of human genomes, you need to you basically need to know this, that you actually do comparison of sequences to a large extent. That's the start of it. Okay, so this is a bit of motivation for bioinformatics and programming. So just mainly for fun, so what is the history of programming language? So computers started arriving, I guess, during the Second World War, sometimes in that era. And first of all, basically this tube-based big thing assembled, so basically they could program. So in the beginning, they were very, very hard coders. You made, really made them to do a simple task. But then they started occurring some kind of languages. The first one is ADA, which is this one. Was language. And then later in the 60s, 70s, both Fortran and C become very much standard, in particular Fortran for scientific computing, and C later. And then I will talk a bit more, then there were some what's called object-oriented languages, they're kind of a way to put functions and the data together. So this is basically for all like Windows and all these more modern ways of have desktops, it's a very efficient way of programming. But also Python is also very object-oriented, so it's very related things. And so these are all hard-coded programs. You come up with extremely fast programs and they're very efficient, but at least it used to take some time to get started with, because you need to write a program, you need to compile it and then run it and test it, and it was not very easy as it started. So actually a lot of bioinformatics was done with what's called scripting languages, which is kind of simplified languages that are very extremely simple to start with. So you really can just start typing on the first line, and it's like it used to be a bit more inefficient in running the code, so it's a bit slower. For instance, Perl, everything is always a string, so if you have a number, it has to convert it from a string to a number every time you do something. So that takes some time. But they have also evolved, and they are, so nowadays you can actually, if you do it the right way, you can actually write quite good and fast code it. And particularly what's good about both Perl and Python, Ruby and Shorebuds, is that a lot of tools out there that people or other people use, that you can reuse. And they're for free, and it's just download them in a standard way of distributing it. So this comes out with Perl or BioPython. And lots of things are already there, which makes it much, much easier to get started. And so, and also nowadays, of course, we have the internet, and everything is basically anything you have is coupled to everything else. And particularly, it comes to this case now when biological data is very big. You cannot download all the data to your own computer, it doesn't fit. So what you do is that you often have to go out on the net and pick up something and then get it out. So it's a lot of communication, which of course is somehow is slow, but it's fast enough as long as you don't want to do billions or millions of sequences. So you have a lot of, and you also sometimes you just get data. Sometimes actually you go and ask for the computing somewhere else. So if you want to use predictive memory protein, you go to my server, submit a request, and you get a reply half a minute later, or depends on what you need. So there's a way of distributing data often. So there are tools for that also. Okay, so another key concept of programming is that you always will make mistakes. And a mistake in a program is called a bug. And the reason is because in one of the first problems that the computer was at 345, they found a fly in between two panels in old computers. So it was a bug there that actually made the program not work. So it was a real bug. And from that on, at least I'm sure it's true, first actual case of bug being found. And this started at 8 in the morning, and it didn't work correctly, and then Det var one they put in the tapes. Sometimes those days the computer program was on tapes. And it was not small tape recorders. The only that was big things to put in there and run. And it didn't work. It started testing and they found the number 70 panel F. There was a moth in there. So they had to find it and take it away and then it worked. So there was a bug. So this is actually my any program you write always in some way has some bugs. It's always like you never think about all possibilities. It's like it's always something happens and it always takes time. So basically just be prepared. You have to go back and check it and things like that. And particularly if someone else is using it, because if it works fine for you, someone else is using it, actually often you don't explain everything you want to do, so they are kind of lost in your way of thinking. So you had to get started. It's not a history based. So this is my favorite language, and this is Fortran. I was not really born then, but almost. So that's and this kind of old big computers. And so COBOL, it was like for a while it was all the computer systems for all the banks were written that. So in the year 2000, if you're a COBOL programmer, which means that you're probably at least 60 years old, you could make a lot of money for the 50 millennium bug that ever really existed. But and then it was also in terms of basics. Basic is for many people the first language you learn. So for us, I had more fun program home computers. They were all written in basic languages there. So the basic was very simple. But somehow it's very similar to what you do in Fortran or in C. It was just more limited, but it was also faster in little things. So you had things like you start a program, you go to one line or two, you print something here, and you end. Where here, and you had often line numbers in each line here. But here, basically, you do similar things. You have some comments, and you write something like that, and C looks slightly different. And C becomes the standard. So basically, every thing in the basic of every computer today, still today, is written in C. So this is really the standard language for many things. And it's also actually, if you want to ask something, and the reason C is efficient is because it basically forces you to write things that are very similar in the way that the computer calculates it. So you basically have variables and very strict things. And it's very easy to write, convert it from the C to the assembler language that is beyond on the basic on the computer. And then you come on to your Pascal, the next first language I learned at university. C++ arrived in 83, which was kind of an extension to C. We had this object orienting. Perl arrived in 87, which was Python 91. So really, well, this existed. So around the millennium, or in the 90s, people started using this kind of languages much more. Both Perl and Python was very well used. Ruby was something that this was a hot some years ago. I don't know, my students use it any longer. PHP, I don't think exists anymore. Java was it still was runs in or pretty JavaScript. It was running inside all the web browsers. So basically, anything that is Google Docs or anything is basically JavaScript, which is also a very scripting language, very simple language. But given the power of the internet and given the power of computing, things like that, you can write really advancing is you can write Google Earth in JavaScript. But we in bioinformatics we really don't use it except for web servers, or part of web servers, and it's part of all the things to use. And Ruby on Rails was a version of Ruby that was popular for a while. So this is some data on popularity in 2011, and yeah, C++ and C, and Java, yeah, Python up here from a Visual Basic. There are a number of languages, but still it's like the this in general is not in bioinformatics. I was saying bioinformatics. I think people do C++ or Python or Perl. Some people have done Java, but not that many, I think. So a key concept here is for Python, I think we're talking about these object-oriented program languages. So as I told you before, a normal computer language, you have variables. You say A equals 5, B equals 6, and then C equals A plus B, and then C becomes 11. So that's very straightforward. But in an object-oriented program, you try to put these functions and the data or the variables together. So you basically say what type of data you have. So you can have, and so if you have a function that is a plus, if A and B are two strings, then you add them together. So if A is hello and B is word, you get hello world. But if you have A is 5 and B is 6, and you add them together, you get 11. So this thing starts in sometimes in the early 80s, 90s, and it's become more and more standard. Because you really, the good thing is that you kind of avoid a lot of problems. You find things that you can, what you can do with your data is also inherited in the description of the data. And I guess the first languages were something called Eiffel and Smalltalk and so on. But particularly C++ and versions of that. But also Java. Java is very similar to C++. And Python are to a large extent object oriented. So we can have an object. So if I want to go and get the data from a sequence from a database, I can use the same structure and I can just tell you what where the data comes from. I can just get it from GenBank or from PDB or from my own database. But for my, I just add change this identify where to get from it, but the rest of the data looks the same. So Python? Oh my. So why Python? So Python is, as I said, it's a scripting language. I can start Python and I can start doing things directly. I don't have to write the program and compile it. I can start doing it directly. It is perhaps easy to use. It's it has a few particular formatting things that are a bit different from most other languages. Particularly, what it matters were how many spaces you have at the beginning of each line. This is important. Otherwise, you have to have parentheses, which is right. It has some problems, but it's also the nice thing that it kind of forces you to write code that looks kind of nice to read. It is object-oriented by completely, so you can easily change things in the basic in the objects and then just keep your data as it is. And most importantly, it's widely used in bioinformatics. It's really, I haven't looked at BioPerl the last few years, but at least in the BioPython has a lot of functions that are very, very useful. It has a lot of statistics, a lot of machine learning. It has a lot of good ways of making nice graphs. So there's a lot of tools out there. There are probably too many tools. So you have to decide which one to use. You can't just try them all. You pick something that you want to use. But there's a lot of things for making things that we do are it's very useful. So I will go through a little bit on. I mean, this is what you would do in the labs today and tomorrow and tomorrow. But I just show you some examples that I hope will work. So we have. I will give you some basic examples of Python, see if it works. I haven't actually tested them, but I hope so. And a bit about different numbers, types, operators and functions they can call. So you have this is what you do. So you need to specify your problem, you design your algorithm, you test it, and then you code it up in your language and you have a program. It has a bit of a different syntax than most other languages, which is good and bad. It's somehow it's elegant, but it also has some differences from other languages that makes it people use without regions in languages a bit confused. It has a lot of built-in data types like numbers, string lists, and particularly dictionaries. So dictionary is basically something that describes data from whatever phone box, and I want to have a name, and I can have like phone number of Pelle Pettersson, and I have phone number as a dictionary, instead of have phone number of entry one and then the name, and I have so a lot of things that are very useful, and this is very useful for bioinformatics, because of course if you have each protein, for instance, in the genome, I can have dictionary that quickly looks up. It's like a database almost. Another actually important thing which is very useful in bioinformatics is the string operation. So basically, I want to have a string, which is a basic sequence, and I want to take one part of it to change it to something else. I can easily do that built in easily. And that is, if you do it in C++, you have to have a special program that do it. There are tools to do it, but they're not built in directly. Perl has the same advantage. And often things are very simple. Often I have a data set. I want to take the fourth column of this data and multiply it with the second column. So exactly what you do in Excel, but you want to do it for 5 million data points. And you want to take the average of these, or the square of the average, or whatever. That things like that are really fast to do. It's 3 lines of code, and you can do it very quickly. And this is what you want to do. So, as I said, C++ is probably maybe what many people used before. Perl was for a long time the bioinformatics standard, but I think it's dying. So I don't know, and particularly no one that I know has started using big Perl projects for the last 5 years at least. There's still a number of people still using it for old things, but all the new students do Python or something else. So you have a few things. You have a comment, which is dash sign in your comments. So everything with dash sign is ignored. And often you have, there's some standards that I'm not very good at following, but there are Python standards. You should start your program with this type of lines. So you really should have something that describes what the program is doing. And I am a lazy person, so I don't do it, but I should, because it really helps in the long run. Because nobody remembers what you did a year ago. So you have something and you don't remember the details. And it always takes time to read some other code. So if you have a good description, it really helps in the long run. And particularly if you have more people sharing some code. It really, really helps. There are also, if you have a variable, in other languages often, you need to decide. You say A is an integer variable, so you can only have integer numbers. Or something like that. You have to declare it. This you do not need to do in Python or in Perl. You just type it. A equals L, or identify it equals L, and it figures out itself. There are some restrictions. It has to start with letters, things like it can be sensitive. And it can only contain letters, numbers, or underscores. So you can't contain colon or percent signs in the name. They are special signs. But basically, anything with letter, normal name, or you can have the number there. And also, you cannot do some particular words that you cannot use, which are the words that are specific for. There are some conventions, and you don't have to follow them, but it's kind of good if you do. If you have something with all uppercase letters, if you write a capital number, you have it. That is a constant. There's something you never change. So it's like if you want to have pi, you write pi with pi and the capital letters, and you write 3.141597, etc. Often, which is a way that more and more people use, is that they use quite long variable names. So if you want to have something that contains sequence alignment, you know, alignment sequence, either in one of these ways, either with a capital S A or with a dash in between. But it gets quite long and complicated, particularly if you need to type it many times. There are, of course, modern editors, modern computer tools helps you to type it. But if you need to type these 20 letters every time you type it and you use it 500 times, it's the probability you don't do any mistakes and happens to type alignment sequences, sometimes or something like that, it's very low. So maybe it's better to use something in between. like not too long names. That's at least in contrast in all classical program used to X, Y, Z. So but then of course you never know what was X and what was Y and Z. So this how your names actually describe what you have is also a good idea. So basically you should avoid X's and Y's. Numbers are normal integers, it's just like that. -3, 7, that. You can have very, very long number integers, so basically numbers that are unlimited size. If you really want to have integer number, normally if you have the computers made such a way so you have some limits on how big and how small integer numbers you can have. It used to be 32,000, but now it's probably 10 to 7 or 10 to 8 or something like that. But there are ways, so you can have L at the end, it can be unlimited size. You can have 10,000 numbers there. And it still treats as an integer number with all numbers there, not as just a floating point number or something like that. So floating point numbers are like that, 1.2, 3.14, or with an exponential. And that's... You have also kind of octahexadecimal, you can have complex numbers. And it just works. You have to anywhere between anything like that. And you can do all the normal things with these things. So what if z if y equals 5 and z equals 3, what will x be in these cases? If we first add it, what is x here?
8.
Yeah. And next?
2.
Yeah. And next? Yeah. And next. What is 5 divided by 3? This is going to be complicated.
1.6.
No, it's not.
It's 1.
Just to confuse you. And the reason. Actually, this is on the way to change. In Python 2.7, it is 1. I think the default in Python 3 is that it's 1.667, etc. And but default is that it counts as integer numbers. So it should really x divided by 5 divided by 3 is but the integer part is 1, and the remainder or modulus is 2. We should write as that. So it really has. If you had type in 5.0 and 3.0 here, so then you would have got 1.67. And I think in the new Python 3, which is not really used that much anymore, and not yet, I think it will be 1.67.
What if you wrote 5.0 divided by 3?
Then I think it still will be. Well, we haven't tried. Let's try. I think it will be. I need to sit down, otherwise I will not be able to see and type. So let's try. So we try Python. Hopefully I have Python installed. Yes, I do. X equals 5.0. Y equals 3. X divided by y. But if you type x equals 5 and then type x divided by. Yeah. So it's enough to one of them. I guess it works the other way around also. But.
Time for having a break.
Well, I think maybe it's a small break time now. A good thing. And
Oliver, look at my t-shirt.
Okay, so time, stop Facebook and time for more programming. So let's continue with some basic things. That is, most of these things are of course quite common to all languages. So sometimes there are syntactic differences, but this is the simple addition and subtraction is only kind of obvious. The other thing that is very important is often to compare things. We want to, you want to find, say, a sequence that is longer than 100 amino acids. You take, you read your sequence somehow, you check the length of it, and you check if it's longer than 100. And then you use greater than. Or you can use greater or equal than, or less than equals, or not equal, or equal. And it also depends sometimes if you want to compare numbers or strings. But basically, in Python, this is all the same. So if you have two strings to compare, you compare to the strings are the same, they're equal. And if it's greater, I guess it's course alphabetic or not. So, and the values are actually so that if they are 1, I mean, also the comparisons is somehow it's like becomes number 0 or 1. And you can combine, so if it's 1, it's true, if it's 0, it's false. And then you can combine things also with logical terms, like in any basic philosophy course, and or not, x or, and things like that. So if you have, if you want to compare many things, if it's greater than 100, longer than 100, and if it's the fourth letter in the string is an A, you write, if length is larger than 100, and position 4 is equal to A, then it's true, anything else is false. So we have some simple tests you can do. If x is smaller than y plus z, here x is 1, y is 4, and z is 14, the x 1 is smaller than 18. So this, you get the value, you get true. Is e, y, the same as 2 times x plus 3? So is y 4 equals 2 plus 3 equals 5? No, it's not. It's false. Is z less than x plus y? Is 14 less than 5? No, it's not, it's false. Is z larger than x? Is 14 larger than 1? Yes, true. Is x not equal to y? X and y are different. Yes, that's true. So this kind of simple comparison is also one of the basic things you do all the time. And if you do logics, you have things like, is x smaller equal to 1 and y equals to 3. No, x is actually smaller equal to 1, but y is not equal to 3, so it's false. But if you do an or here, so x, then it's one of these, it's enough that one of these are true. And x is actually smaller equal to 1, so then the answer is true. If is x bigger than 1? No, it's not, but if you have not, if you invert basically everything, like in logics, it's not. So that means that x actually the answer, whole answer is true. You can type it like that instead, you don't have parentheses, so you have not of x. And so basically that means if x is then equal to 1, x not of x is actually, x is actually true, so then it will be false, and then it's actually 0, and then 0 is not larger than 1, so it's false. And here you also see if you put parentheses differently, it's like any mathematics. You start with parentheses. So you take this expression here is the same as here, so that was true. But not of true is false. If it's not true, it's false. If it's not false, it's true. So this is same as in any basic philosophy. But so yes, keep track of where you put parentheses and what you actually mean. Strings. Strings you put quotes around. So if you want to write a string, put either double quotes or single quotes. Both things work equal well. You can't really mix them because then it gets confused. So if you want to have a string with a quote in a single quote, you better start with double quotes or vice versa. Otherwise, I think you need to put a backslash in front of them. So a string, say hello world, is a classical string in computer programming. And a string is basically a vector, so it's a list of characters. So you can take a and in most computer languages, if you have a vector things, you always start at position zero. Really, for old traditional things, reasons, no other reasons, and people like it, dislike it, but you can't really do anything about it. So position zero in this string is an H. Position one is the E. And two is L. Actually, position minus one, if you have minus one, you start counting with other, so minus one is the first character from the back, from the end of the string. Minus zero is supposed to be the same as zero.
Sorry, does the space count like another?
Space counts, yes. So the string, and every character counts. So, so space is it's every, this is just any character. I think even if you have Chinese characters there, I even think they count as a single character. It a little bit depends. I think you can. I can't type Chinese characters, but I think you can. So yeah, this is the this position here is basically minus one is the last, minus two is the next to last, etc. So you have with strings, of course, there are a number of things you want to figure out. So strings is very sequences are basically strings. So strings are very important in bioinformatics. You want to know the length of it. So you type the length, and of course, like in many computer languages, you shorten things, you type len only. And then parentheses. So this is basically a way to calling a function or an object. You take the len, and you call it the function, it means that you put the variable in parentheses. And then the variable you put in here, in this case, is the variable my string. And the number is 12. So it's 12 characters here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. If you type hello plus word, so you can do plus, you can addition or two strings together, you get hello word without the space this time, because you didn't put a space there. So space is, in this case, space is nothing special at all. This is a bit of way of writing. Basically, you can format it, things like that. You can actually tell this one to type this command here in the string here. So it's a way to format the output of a printing function, actually. So it formats things like in other commands, it's called sprintf. So if you want to put things together, for instance, you want to have a variable name, not just hello here, you want to add something in front here, you can type like that. And you can still, so basically, this is a bit special, but it's, you can have plus, so you can do and things like that. I don't think you can do multiplications or minus and even. Word is not the same as hello. So you can do comparison. But here, then you compare exactly if the strings are the same or not. So word equals the word is one or two. So you can compare exactly as you would expect it to do.
So you basically can say that my string second equals my string my string fifth equals my string seventh rows.
Yes, if you are fair, yeah. Five and yes. Four, eight. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, actually, it's 4. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 4 and 7. Yeah. Are the same. So, yeah, they are the same. Or 0, 1, 2, and 3 are the same. And you can do, actually, you can even do comparisons. And it's basically just alphabetic comparison. If A is small, A is smaller than B. I guess it's using the ASCII code, so exactly how it deals with where pluses and minus and exclamation marks end up, you gotta think. But in alphabetic, it's like that. And I think, I'm pretty sure it separates capital and non-capital letters. But they're also a good function where you can take a string and change it to all capital. There's a function to do that. So uppercase and type the string root. So all the string comparisons are quite easy. And you can do take parts of them, which is also very useful in bioinformatics. So I can start with position 2 and then take to the end, or I can start from the beginning and take until position 3, or I can start with position 1 to 3 and I get this part of it. I can make uppercase. My another type. My this is like this is really object oriented way of writing it. You can write. So then I write my string and I write object here upper. This is a command that works on it. So take the string and make uppercase of it, and it turns into spoon. Capital letters and then spoon. Well, I can do replace. I can write all the small o's, on lowercase o's, uppercase o's. So lot of things like that you can do it. In principle, also what, if you don't remember what to do, you Google for it and you figure it out. So try to describe the problem in some problem. And so you can do that. So string is typically in mathematics is a sequence. A list is actually, it's not about a string, but instead of having every position in a string as a character, any position here can be something, can be a little bit what you want. So it's a list of things, basically. But somehow it's still like a string. So I have here my list is A, B, 3.58, D, and 4, and 0. So it's a mix of characters, floating point numbers, and integer numbers. So this is a list of things that I... So the first position here still is zero, just to confuse people. And that's an A. Third one, this is number two, is 3.58. I can do the same thing here, I can do it from the back.
Quick question.
Yes?
You can nest your list as well, right? So you can put lists within lists.
Yeah. So I can take some part of it and I can check if this B exists in this list. So there are B here, yes, but E is not. Well, E is not in my list. Yeah. So I can so built-in things. It's fine. I have a list of things that I can see if it's there. I can add things at the end. Append at the end, for instance. So these are easy things, standard variable things to do, which most computing languages are similar yet, but it's often you need to declare things in more details in here. Dictionaries is actually another very, very useful thing, as I said before, which is not built into all other languages. So basically, it's like a table of lookup things. So I have an entry, which is B, and then a value is 3. So A, 4, and 75 is 2.85. So if I looked at the entry, you see I have another type of parentheses here. I have this square parentheses. And then I have... so entry, if I ask for what the dictionary for B is, it's 3. 75 is 2.85, and A is 4. So this is really useful if you want to have a list of all sequences. For instance, you have the identifier of the sequences here, and then you have the sequence references. So I don't have to remember which sequence is number 1 and 2 and 3. It's just you're looking up things. So it's, I mean, Perl has a very similar way to doing it. And it's really useful because it really makes it easy to maintain things. So you are, another important thing is actually to input and export things. So you can either import data, and there are ways to do that quite simply. And you can force it a bit between the format, but normally it reads in the input line and figures out what it should be. So if it's a string, it's a string, it's a floating point number, it's like that. But, if you want to, default is a string, but if you want to convert it, you can just use conversion programs like that. So there are, so for instance, if you do an example. So if I, let's show if this works, this small program. Where did I have my, there. My string equals raw input. Enter a string.
Okay.
My string list. Så, känner jag ändå den.
Seven.
Ändå. If I do int of my string, I get 7.
So this is 7 is a string and
7 is a number. So default is it's a string.
And I can output, I can type normally yes to print and then the variable for that. And it prints normally in a decently looking format. Print A, B, C. A, B, C. Well, this is string. Print A, string A, string B, string C. And then it puts a nice space in between them. But instead of a print A, B, C, you have a plus in between them and print them together. So that's... So here you actually get a new line. So this is more or less what you expect it to look like if you want to print out the format. If you print three different things, you're going to print in space in between. If you want to have a comma at the end, actually you're going to have two new lines. No, then you get a new line. But here, if you want to print that, you get no spaces. So an example, you can print hello, comma word. And then see, I can add in another print hello again. So this is, let's have another command on the same line. So hello word, hello again. But here I put another comma here, you see. And I get all at once. And then I did this way that I could print for the form of the string. This is very useful if you want to print something and I want to have a variable printing here. So I just put in pluses and I put in formatting there. I put the string, what I want to print as a variable in the end. Hello code and code word. If I do hello, code, plus, space, and cruel word, I'll get it like that. Don't know why I need this extra space in me. Maybe it's two spaces. No, I didn't get spaces. Okay, so as you've seen already, I can type Python programs
direct like here. So this is running Python here. I can do it.
So I can do things. I can do a program here. And I have it.
So I can do small programs and do that. But of course, normally what you do is not that you type all the commands online like that. Instead, I write the program. So I write it once and then I run it from the command line. So you normally start some kind of editor. So I'm normally using something like, let's leave this here. And I do Emacs. Test Python, normally like that. And then I'll type A equals 5, B equals A times A. Save it. And then I'll turn like Python test. And it prints it out like that. That's a normal way of running a program. I can also do it actually, I can do it like this. If I tell it that this is a Python program, which is one way to do it, is like type it like that. And I have to tell that it is executable. Then I can run it like that. So I can tell it.
Without having Python, it doesn't really matter.
So normally what you do is that you make your program somehow in an editor. This is just one that I usually use, but there are quite good ones. And what you see also, actually, even this simple abstraction do some coloring. So it colors the words, recognizes in that, which is kind of useful. It can do some automatic indentions if I want to have. With Python, I haven't showed yet.
If.
Go like that. And I have things that are. I should have two equal signs there. Ah, I don't like this one ASCII character. So. I can probably change it somehow. Because it saved us some strange characters and Unicode character. What you say here, what nice thing here is actually that in Python it's extremely important that you have spaces in between. So you have an indention here, so this is a number of spaces in between, it means that this is a part of this loop here. So if I do something here, if I do print test here, and then I do let's do the data set. So now it knows that if A not equal to B, actually you know this, and not this part here. But this part here, it knows now that it's not a part of this if statement. In other languages you would have parentheses or some curly parentheses, but here is really what's important part is that you have how many indentions you have in the space, how many spaces you have in the beginning.
So it will print anyway.
It will not print this part here, but this one is though. So this is just this is where the next program continues. I can write A equals 5 or 7, I think so. I can look at that. So this is when it finished the whole thing. So we did hey and no test. Run here, find on this, and then skip this part and look around our content. So this is, because this is back to the original part here. So this is the key thing. And this is the things also the editor somehow help you with taking care of. Because you have a good editor, it sort of makes sure that you have things more or less right, correctly indented. Or in other languages, it makes sure that you have the right number of parentheses or something like that. I'm not really sure what is default on the computer in here, but there are many different ones, and it's a matter of taste. I used Emacs because I used it since I was a baby. No, not really, but since you were babies. Then next thing that actually is probably the main reason to use. Well, one of the main reasons to use Python is BioPython. So BioPython is a set of modules that are already written by someone that does many, many things that we want to do in bioinformatics. A lot of things based on it. So they can read sequences, and particularly all these things that we as bioinformaticians often do, like converting sequences from one format to another format, or finding things in the database, and things that you maybe use a web server or whatever. It's all there from command lines in BioPython. We will not have that much time in this programming tutorial to get to BioPython. I think the last lab is a bit about BioPython. But it's if you're starting a project, look what is done in BioPython. Just Google on it and you find projects, you find things that are there. And I'm sure that even what I present here is not out of date, because this is a couple of years old. So. But Python.org is the official site. This is BioPython.org. Or the other pages, there are tutorials how to use and so on. There are quite good things. This is a bit the web page we are using for the labs today. It's something from France, for Pasteur. It's getting a bit old, so some things don't really work as they should, but it's it's a decent instruction. There are two different courses there. And another good tool is actually called SciPy. It's scientific Python. I have a lot of very, very good tools, particularly for plotting and so on. There's something called Matplotlib that is very good. So there are a lot of things you can do here. You can find PDB files, you can find databases of all the regulations, you can get things from databases, you can do different Markov models and lots of secrets IO. A lot of things I don't even know what they are, but there's a lot of different tools of it. I'm sure this is just can you look how many there are today?
Good question.
Yes?
Are these open source?
Everything, yes. I think everything should be open source. I don't know really the rules for these things, but.
No, but if you want to go and look at the code, you can.
Yeah. Sure. It's all there. I think that Python should be GPL, but I'm not 100% sure there. But something similar at least. And I think that I never had a problem with looking at something there. There might be. But in principle, I don't know the exact rules, but I think basically open source, everything you just get at it. It doesn't mean that it's always that easy to read it, but it's really. So yeah, here is a lot of whole hierarchy. It's quite a lot of things. So of course you use what you want, and obviously it's not always exactly what you want. Sometimes you need to modify a little bit, but in general it's there, and there are things development, so if you can use it, it's always a good thing to use. And of course, if it's not exactly what you want, or the best thing is actually to contribute to it and fix it, or add the things, or you do it. But that might take a longer time. So just some simple things you can do. Like you can actually do it online. Start Python. Everything is installed here, I hope so. And then you type. So what you do is when you import a module. So I want to import the sequence IO module. It's called like from bio import seq IO. Yeah, it worked. Oh, I need a sequence file. Okay, I haven't done that. I have to go back here. So basically, I can do it. I can open my file. FASTA is a format of sequence files. It's standard format of protein sequence. It's a hemoglobin sequence here, and then it can just basically has only two lines or two entries. It has the ID and the sequence. So I can open this. I can parse it, and I have the ID. That's one part in the SR, and the other one is the sequence. And the good thing is, okay, now I want this one, but there's another sequence format called GeneBank. It looks like that. I do exactly the same thing. The only thing I can tell you is the GeneBank format instead. I get exactly the same thing. Or I can use a UniProt database. It's another format. I mean, it contains extra things also, but it's another format. I read like that. Or it's called Swiss for some historical reasons. It's called SwissProt. We will know more about it later.
Getting them from the database or
the file? No, this was the sequence. Next line is when you get from the database. This is actually work. So if I let's see if this works. Well, let's see. So this is if I do like that, and I do also import something called entres. And then you need to type in this like him. Like that, and then I can get it from why I can't do that. No. Well, something changed since I did last time. Mm.
Well, in principle, if I look up it, not yet work, not this year.
Change format. So that, yeah, so basically I can go down three and pick fetch this, and I can go to hang on the gene and I use the gene bank format. And I can do the same thing.
Or I can use
another database. I can of course write it in the faster format. I can at least convert things within databases. If I set the format correct. So in general I would advise you to use much bypass as you can, but it's always something you need to do, particularly glues in between it, you can fix it. And of course it takes some time to learn it. So if you do something very simple, very small, it might be easy to do it yourself, but sometimes they're a bit over complex. And so sometimes it's easy to do it yourself. But it's if there is something out there, it's always good to start looking at it. And particularly this, in general, these models are much better written than what you would do yourself in a simple format. Because they are really someone has spent time writing them, and this is like a handyman in many cases and exceptions. In general, problem is like you think you solve a problem, you think you have a good way of doing it, but it is always some data exception, some naming convention that you don't understand, something like that. So like it works in 95% of cases, but there's always some cases where it crashes. So this is often these things are handled by Python. And of course, if you want to do something that almost works, but you want to extend it, you can always try to fix it. So, this might actually work. Good try. Mm-hmm. So this is a typical example. You can do something very simple. I want to align two sequences, which is what we basically talk about next week mainly. So I do import a program called Pairwise 2. And alignments, I want to do this alignment of these two sequences, different sequences, with these parameters. We'll discuss next week what it means. And then I want to print this alignment 1, alignment 2, and this one. So I do that. And then I actually get all the alignments. So. So here you see, this is the alignment, this is this one, and actually for some reason I printed all 7. So I guess. So let me go up. So the whole on program to do this alignment is actually on this line here. We do alignments with ending like that. This is exactly, so this is a program that is already included in Python that finds the best alignments in these two sequences. And then I have it. Let's have alignments. This is the alignment I have there. So the other one is just basically printing of it later.
Sorry.
Yes?
Your computer
is
going
to
die.
Yes, I know.
Oh, sorry.
No, that's why I'm trying to end up things. Right. And actually, what I should do is probably save my recording. Unfortunately, I forgot my charger at home. I'm almost done, so that's okay. Okay, I'll save it. I think it's done. Hopefully. 3%.